So to begin, we're just going to give some basic definitions from knot theory and topology that we'll need. So a knot is just a smooth embedding of the circle S1 into the three-sphere S3. You can also take R3 instead. They're more or less equivalent. So in particular, a knot is diffeomorphic to a circle. And a link is just a disjoint union of knots that might be tangled together in some way. We distinguish knots up to ambient isotopy, which basically corresponds to continuous deformations. We study knots using diagrams, which we get by just projecting them onto two-dimensional hyperplanes. When we do this, we're going to get some crossings, as you can see in the diagrams on the bottom left. The crossing number is defined to be the minimum number of crossings in a diagram K. Some examples of knots are the unknot, the trefoil 3-1, and the figure 8-4-1. And we have the hop link on the right. We can distinguish knots from one another from their diagrams using Rademeister groups, which basically allow us to eliminate unnecessary crossings. You can see the three groups here. And if we orient a knot diagram just by giving it a direction, then we can assign a sign to each of its crossings with the right-hand rule. And then we can define the linking number of the two-component links just to be the sum of the signs of all the crossings between the two components divided by two, and that will be relevant later.
First introduce the unknown number. As we can maintain to an unknown by several crossing changes. So the unknown number is the minimum number of crossing changes that can be made to an unknown. And I will illustrate the bandwidth by an example, the knot 6-1. As we see, the knot K is originally two unknowns, and by doing a bandwidth, we mean that we add another band B. We see if we delete the interior of the band B and we keep other two edges, we get another knot k prime. So k prime is obtained by doing a band move on knot k. And next, we say that if k can be obtained from the hop link by a single band move, then k has a bending hop representation. We have a theorem stating that if k has unknown number one and it is obtained from the, it has a bending hop link representation. So the trefoil is a good example for illustrating this theorem. Like for trefoil, we see if we change this crossing, we can make it into an unknown. Then we add another unknown and we do a bandwidth. We can see here that if we delete the interior of this band, we can keep these two edges, we can get back to the trefoil. So this is exactly the band presentation of the trefoil. And to do several steps as of this, we can get the hop link with the band. So trefoil has its bending hop link presentation. We also give the definition that if the knot K has a bending hop link presentation and the band does not cross each component of the hop link, then we say K is a twisty white double. We also define that if K can be obtained from the unknown by repeatedly twisting this node and link the ends together, then K is a twist node. We give three very obvious examples of the twist.
Now we'll introduce several concepts before we introduce the surgery on knot. The first is that if K is a knot in S3, then like it's a turbulent neighborhood, like NK here is homomorphic to a solid torus because K itself is homomorphic to a circle. And the boundary of that neighborhood is a torus. And we define the meridian mu of K to an unknot just like lying around on that boundary that K crosses exactly once. And the longitude is just a parallel copy of K lying on that boundary as well, so that down here. And the isotopic classes of curves in a torus is a bijective correspondence with a set of extended rational numbers. So given the knot K in S3, where the boundary of a neighborhood of K is a torus, then any extended rational number P over Q determines a curve beta on the boundary of the neighborhood K that is well defined. Intuitively, you can see like the example of two curves here, that P is the number of times the beta goes around the meridian, and Q is the number of times the beta goes around the longitude, respectively. So we can use the curve to define the three manifold, that's called PQ surgery of K. And here's a formal definition of a surgery, but intuitively, it's just you remove the interior of the neighborhood K, and you get a cavity there, and you glue a new solid torus back. By like identifying the meridian of new solid torus with a curve like beta specified by some extended rational number P over Q. And we call P over Q the surgery slope. And the surgery of a link is naturally extended because a link is just this joint union of knots. And it's interesting because if we can do like if each pure Q that specifies the surgery coefficients of each of the link components, then we just do surgery on the link by doing surgery along each of these components. It's interesting because any closed oriented connector through manifold can be obtained by doing surgery along the frame link. So we can in fact think of any three manifold in terms of diagram for frame link, which we call surgery diagram. And Anton introduced Kirby calculus.
So just study surgery diagrams, we use Kirby calculus. So using something called singularity theory from 4D topology, it's possible to show that if you have two surgery diagrams on which Dane surgery gives the same three manifold topomorphism, then those two diagrams are related by a sequence of curved moves. And so the point is that these moves preserve the surgery. And given any three manifold, you can go from you can traverse between all of the diagrams that give that three manifold using those moves. So first is the handle side, where you slide one parallel to the other. And the effect is that you can change the linking number between two of the components. Next is the rolls and twists components, and you can replace negative one over n framed a knot with an n twist of the string. And this then you take any meridian and you can remove it using this one. And one consequence is that if you have a minus one over n frame meridian on a zero frame on knot, then you can replace that with that knot but with n frame. So we can see some examples here. If you take one over zero surgery on any knot, it just corresponds to drilling out that tubular neighborhood and then gluing it back the way it was, so it just gives us the again. Using the rules and twists, you can show that one over n surgery on the knot also gives us three. And this lambda shows that if you have a half link with coefficients zero and n, that also gives us three. So one final consequence of this lambda is that if you have a zero frame meridian on any knot, then you can remove both the knot and the meridian from any surgery diagram without changes.
And now we're ready to introduce the surgery dual of a knot. Naturally, K-zers lies in the core of its terminal neighborhood. But when we do PQ surgery on K, the new solid torus that we glue back in the manner specified by PQ or Q goes at the core. And that determines a new knot gamma in the surgery manifold, which we call the surgery dual K. And if the slope is an integer, we can see that on the surgery diagram, the dual gamma k can be represented as the meridian k. And we prove a lemma later that surgery duality of knots in S3 is symmetric, which is kind of obvious here, but it's important for our work.
Goals and results, producing knots with the same surgery. During the first part of our research, our goal was to study knots with the same surgery. We did this by using Picarello's construction, which was developed last year based on the older construction dualizable patterns. So basically, L is a surgery diagram for some three manifold Y with components red, blue, and green. R is a zero frame unknot, while B and G have integral framings and a linking number of zero. If we ignore either B or G, then R becomes isotopic to the other. Following these conditions, we can produce knots K and K prime by handle sliding and removing two components. The resulting knots will be homeomorphic to each other under end surgery.
So there's another construction for getting knots with the same surgery due to Baker and Motegi, and it's actually more or less equivalent to Picciarillo, but it's a little more abstract and better suited for theoretical purposes. So the following is kind of our adaptation of the construction. So the saying is we have a knot K, and we suppose we can take an unknot C linked with K such that 0, 0 surgery on the link K union C is S3. Then we have a way of getting knots KN prime for each integer N that have the same N surgery as K. So first we define K prime to be the surgery dual to C in S3. Then it turns out K prime has the same 0 surgery as K. We also define C prime to be the surgery dual to K. And after some Kirby calculus, we'll see in a second that C prime is actually an unknot linked with K prime in S3. So in particular, we can twist K prime through C prime as in a Rolfson twist. This gives us knots kn prime for each integer n, and these happen to have the same n surgery as k. And if c is not a radiant to k, then we can actually conclude that at most finitely many of these knots are the same as k, so that for all the finitely many integers, we get a knot different from k with the same surgery. So that's a very abstract description, but we were able to develop the following more constructive way of actually finding diagrams for the knots k n prime using Kirby calculus. So on the upper left, you see we have this link k union c, where k is black and c is red. And we claim that 0, 0 surgery is S3, but that's not obvious from the figure. We've added meridians to the two components. So the blue is the meridian to c, that's the surgical k prime that we define. The yellow is the dual to k, which is c prime. Notice that c prime is minus 1 over n frame, so by a slam dunk move, we can delete it and change the framing on k to n. We can also remove blue and red from the light bulb trick. So this says that the diagram is the same as n surgery on k. And we want to show that it's also the same as n surgery on kn prime. To do that, we need to remove the black and red components from the diagram using Kirby loops. So the first thing we do is we slide black over red until we get the diagram on the upper right. And notice in this diagram, if we remove blue, then red is just a meridian to k. And we want to be able to remove red and black using a light bulb trick. So now to get rid of these extra crossings between blue and red, we slide blue over black in that middle region three times in this case. Afterwards, C is going to be a zero frame meridian to K, so we can remove the both of them. Then we're just left with blue and yellow, and as I said, C prime is an unknot linked with K prime. Lastly, we can do a Rolfson twist, and that changes the framing on KN prime to N, and we finally get the knot that we wanted with the same answer. So now we want to be able to produce these links K union C in certain practical circumstances to work with individual knots. If K is unknotting number one, there's a method that we originally got from a paper in Picciarillo, and we use the band presentation. So if you take a hop link and slide one component over the other using the band as an instruction, then one component is going to remain the zero frame unknot, that's the red in the diagram on the bottom. The blue will become the knot K by construction. And notice the framing on K is plus or minus 2, but if we adjust the initial framing on the hop link to 2 with the opposite sign, then at the end we're going to get 0, 0 framing. So this shows that 0, 0 surgery on K union C is the same as plus or minus 2, 0 surgery on a hop link, and we said before that that's S3. So this gives us a link K union C that fits into Baker mosaic. When K has an unknown number greater than 1, we don't actually have a systematic way of getting these links. What we can do is produce some links K union C where K is some knot with a higher unknotting number. We just don't know what it's going to be in advance. So in this example, we were able to obtain 10.125, which has unknotting number 2, by doing 2 handle slides on a hop link. In general, if you do n slides on a hop link, you can get a knot with unknotting number n. And the diagram on the right is the link K union C. So we can use that to find other knots with the same surgery as 10.125.
So the first thing that we did was to produce a binet hop link presentation for all the 78 tabulated knots with unknotting number 1, have crossing number less than or equal to 10, because our idea was to apply Picciarillo's construction the way we adapted to those knots and produce a knot with the same zero surgery as them. We use a software called KLO, Kirby Calculator, and in the next slide, we can see the screenshots of our work. That's actually what we did. We had a knot in blue, and then we added the meridians in order to produce a knot green with the same zero surgery as that knot. Now introduce the concept of a characterizing slope. So recall that surgery knot is defined by the slope. A characterizing slope is P over Q. If for a knot K and a knot K, this P over Q surgery in K prime is not homomorphic to P over Q surgery in K whenever K prime is not isotopic to K. So what happens is that like we have found that for our knots, whenever K was not a twist knot, K prime was not isotopic to K. That means the zero was not a characterizing slope. Because for characterizing slopes, the knots have to be the same to yield the same surgery. That's what it means. And we can use a similar process to check whether any integer is a characterizing slope. We just have to change the framing at the beginning. So the question that we ask ourselves is, can we check all integer slopes with finally many computations? Because we could check them one by one, but we can't in the end check all of them.
Look at some of the homotopy of characterizing slopes. This theorem actually says that for most knots, most slopes are characterizing. And moreover, for some of them, twist knot,
First of all, to Wisconsin, which are close to the degree, it was shown that all slopes are paramagnetic. And in fact, it was guessed that for all Twistons, all the slopes will be characterizing, but we actually found that that's not true. So on the other hand, there's another theorem, which is the bigger motivic result, that says that for K satisfying this condition, there are infinitely many non-characterizing slopes. So they actually asked whether small knots have infinitely many non-characterizing slopes. And we found some that do. And our work actually shows that for knots or SS for certain conditions, almost all integer slopes are non-characterized. So our first theorem deals with knots with 10 or fewer crossings. So if it has a knotting number 1 and it's not twist knot, then it has at most 1 integer characterizing slope. As we said before, we don't have a systematic way of dealing with knots that don't fit this condition, but we found these isolated results, including this twist knot, which is very surprising. We also found the more general theorem that if K is a knotting number 1 and it's not a twisted white head double, then it has at most finitely met integer characteristics. So to prove the first theorem, the strategy is that we already discussed a method of going from one knot to another knot with the same tensor. So all that remains is to show that it's actually distinct from K. And we do that using hyperbolic geometry. Hyperbolic three-manifold is three-manifold with constantly negatively curved three-point geometry. And a hyperbolic knot is any knot that if you remove the tubular neighborhood from S3, you get a hyperbolic three-manifold. And this allows us to use geometric properties such as the volume of the manifold and the length of the slope, both of which are defined using the metric. So here are some results that are already known about Dane surgery and volume and length. Following Baker Motegi, we find that a knot C linked with K that yields S3 when you do 0-0 surgery. So now we notice that if we add a meridian M to C, then the surgery dual of M is just K in front, the knot that has the same end surgery as K. And that construction fits all the theorems that we just showed. And so what we want to show is that if we want to show that Kn prime is distinct from K, one strategy is that we could show that their volumes are different, then they have to be different knots. And it turns out it's possible to do this for absolute value of n greater than this big n here. So that means that all integer slopes, absolute value of n greater than n, are non-characterized. So that leaves only finitely many remaining cases.
So even there are only finitely many cases for S-test, sometimes it's a lot, that's those 2n plus 1 cases for each knot. So we just wrote a simple computer script that can do that. We use a software called Snappy that is able to calculate the hyperbolic quantities that Anton mentioned. And the script simply prompts for those quantities, then calculates the bound n and writes a text file that is going to be ran for all the 2n plus 1 cases. And we were able to, by analyzing the results, conclude our theorem 1 just by experimenting. And that includes the proof of theorem 1.
Here's theorem 2 again. It is a more theoretical result than the previous one. And the first step is that we strengthen the result shown earlier by Baker Motegi, that we just juxtapose several lemmas and theorems from paper and just observe from just by laying on the couch that it boils down to a symmetry of duality and then extend it to a link. And our proof for this proposition also guarantees our adaption of the Baker-Motegi's theorem to explicitly carry out 0-0 surgery on K union C actually yields K0 prime without any curvy calculus. And then if you twist that at time to get kin primes that we did. So it lays the theoretical ground of like all our previous parts. That's more experimental. And the next step is that just to apply this proposition to prove our main theorem, which I think is more concrete conditions. And recall that for K with unknown number one, Christian already said that the 0-0 surgery on K union C yields S3. So it boils down to show that if K is not twisted whitehead double, which means that in any band presentation for K, the band must cross the disk bound by one of the components. So we developed this dilemma that says that if R union B is the top link, and if you do a handle slide of one component over the other, yielding like the first component is still a meridian and X, then there exists equivalent handle slide by a band that does not cross either component.
So we already look at how we can extend theorem 2 because it begins like conjecture after results from theorem 1. So since in theorem 1 we found that twist knot 8-1, we believe that the assumption on twist knots for theorem 2 can be dropped if we lose in some condition at some point. Same goes for unknown number because we found some knots for unknown number 2 that also fit theorem 1. We believe that we can answer this question if we can produce an algorithm to find the links L equals K union C that fit into Baker Montague construction. So it's just after handle sliding a hot link repeatedly times, you can find a link K and a unknown C that's not meridian to it. We also conjecture that theorem 2 is going to become something. If K is a knot of unknown number 1 and K is not a twist knot, then K has at most 1 integer characterizing slope, plus or minus 2. Because that's actually what we found in theorem 1. We just were not able to prove it with the tools that we had. So what is next now is to rigorously prove the Lehmann representation as Cecilia mentioned for theorem 2, because we have the sketch of the proof, but we don't have a rigorous definition of band presentation in order to write it out. We have to keep experimenting with handle slides in order to expand the list of theorem 1, because some of those knots are actually very important. And maybe use other tools to prove a version of theorem 2 for twisted by handles, and then looking for final conjecture. So that was it. Thank you so much for listening to us. We are open to questions, and sorry if things were a little bit rushed.
So I have a question. So you want to expand the list on your theorem 1.
Yeah.
Can you give a sense of like how many knots are you not? I mean, you're wanting to expand the number of crossings, or you're still doing less than 10? What do you mean exactly by that?
So can you go back to the theorem 1? So knots up to 10 crossings are like, you know, they're a lot, but you can still like kind of see it. They're still tabulated. Knots up to 13 crossings are all tabulated, but after 10 crossings, some of them don't have properties that were found out yet. Like the unknown number of some 11 crossing knots is not known. So we can't quite like go into that territory, and we don't think it's worth it because we only found knots from 8 and 10 crossings there. So we want to keep sliding to find knots of low crossing number, such as 8 something, because there are 20 knots of 8 crossings. And we already found, like, there are 10 of unknown number 1, we already found, like, some 7 more. So we basically almost finished tabulating all knots of 8 crossings. So we believe that if we keep trying, for instance, we couldn't find any of 9 crossings. And we believe that if we keep trying, there might be either a reason why we can't find any of nine crossings, or probably we can still find it if we do the right slide. Because the handle slides to find them are quite random. Because it's not only about like where to draw the band, but also how to draw the band. The band can be framed, that is, can be twisted several times, like infinitely many times. So sometimes we just try with one knot and we produce a lot of knots of 11 crossings, but we just don't list them because it's irrelevant for this part of the theorem.
May I ask a question? So there are only finitely many knots with a bounded crossing numbers, right? So you have bounded it, so you have only finite number of cases. If I'm not mistaken, just now you showed that the proof of the theorem 1, there are many remaining cases that you check by computer. So this theorem 1 actually is, so the work is that the proof somewhere, somehow, is theoretical, but then there are many cases that you just use a computer to check the cases, and then it's okay. Then now I have a table that classifies this finite number of knots into different ones, and then that would be a theorem one, right? So, my understanding is correct.
Yeah, like we do experiments to like theorem one is all experimental proven. Like we tested individually knots because there are, as you said, point of many types of knots. But the slopes, like the thing is that the slopes are not templated. That's the thing that we are kind of adding to the table, the number of slopes that we have.
So what is the significance of this integer characterizing slope that your theorem one first try to provide a list of finite examples of how it behaves differently with crossing number less than or equal to 10, and then theorem two, I think, suddenly becomes something like unlocking number one focus. So what's the significance of doing that essentially? What problems are you solving?
Okay, then go back to those slides that you had.
For theorem one, two,
no, wait, one more slide back. And one more back, maybe. So the thing is that so far, people have thought it's rational slopes, actually, are most likely characterizing. Like, practically all rational slopes are characterizing. But for integer slopes, it's quite different, it's quite the opposite. That's what we have found. And people really believe that small knots, small twist knots, have all characterizing slopes. Because as we said before, like at first, the motivation is that any compact connected tree manifold can be described by surgery in a framed link. So the idea of doing surgery in a knot is describing this manifold in two different ways. So if the slope is non-characterizing, that means there are two ways of describing the same manifold. And sometimes it's easier to look at the surgery diagram for a manifold than to look for the manifold itself to understand its properties. So that's the significance.
Any other questions? All right, thank you everybody for their